Can I add my welcome to you? And so my name is John T. I'm one of the pastors here. It's my privilege to be bringing you God's word this morning. You will need a Bible. This is the last spare Bible in the building. So if anyone needs this, put your hand up and Ewan will bring it to you. I'm going to read from Matthew chapter 5, verse 38. Can someone give me the page number for Matthew chapter 5, verse 38, please? It is page 970. Thank you. It's behind you. Great. I'm going to read for there in a moment. But before we do that, just a few thoughts. So, what do you do? What do you do when you're playing football in the park with friends and friends of friends, and you're cruising down the right wing, about to cross the ball, and you feel from behind you a two-footed tackle that is late, and that brings you crunching to the ground? What do you do? What do you do when you're at home? It's the night before an important assessment at work, and that's the evening your neighbor decides to throw a party outside until 2 in the morning. What do you do when your daughter comes home from school and says that one of her so-called friends has hit her again, and the teacher didn't see it? What do you do? What do you say to her? What do you do when you're at an event? And this evening is going to be possibly the biggest night of your life. Everything your career has been working towards. And so you're there with your wife. Tensions are high. And then someone makes a joke at your wife's expense. A joke which isn't particularly funny. A joke which you know will deeply hurt your wife. A joke which was made in front of 16 million live watchers and will be watched by many more million afterwards. What do you do? This morning, we are wrestling with this question. Is it ever right to fight back? Is it ever right to fight back? Hopefully you can see this isn't some kind of ethical equivalent of a crossword, something which is intellectually challenging, but you can put it down and it will mean nothing for you. This really matters. I think it was C.S. Lewis who once said, To love is to be vulnerable. Well, I think we can put it stronger than that, can't we? To live is to be vulnerable. If anything matters to you, if anyone in this world matters to you, then living in this world, living in a broken world, means at some point you will get hurt. Someone will offend you. Someone will hurt you. Someone will let you down. And when it happens, it will feel like a punch in the stomach. It will feel like a kick in the teeth. I wonder if just this morning, just now as we're sitting here, you can think, when's the last time someone significantly hurt you, either deliberately or accidentally? Can you think of one moment just this morning? I'll give you a few moments. If that's hard for you, that's a wonderful place to be in life. But I wonder this morning, as you think about that moment, will you engage with me? Is it ever right to fight back? Is it ever right to fight back? And for an answer to this question, we're going to turn to possibly the most significant sermon ever preached, possibly the most famous speech ever given. And this is no politician giving us what we want to hear. Just as thousands of years before this moment, Moses, the great prophet and leader of God's people, stood on a mountain and set forth God's vision for his Old Testament people, the Ten Commandments, and the world hasn't been the same since. So here, Jesus, in the Sermon on the Mount, stands on a mountain as God's greatest prophet and God's king with all his authority, and he sets out his vision, a clearer vision, a final vision, for God's spirit-filled people scattered throughout time and throughout the world. And the world has never been the same since. All that to say, we need to listen to what Jesus has got to say this morning. And don't shoot the messenger. We're going to hear some of Jesus' most challenging teachings. I hope you've got Matthew 5:38 in front of you. Let me read it, then I'll pray. You've heard it said, eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you, Do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. And if anyone wants to sue you, take your shirt and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. If anyone forces you to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Give to the one who asks you, and do not turn away from the one who wants to borrow from you. Let's pray. Father, our prayer is that the meditation of my heart and the words of my mouth might be pleasing to you, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Our question is it ever right to fight back? Is it ever okay to fight back? And before we get to verse 39, we have to look at verse 38, which is the context for Jesus' command in verse 39. And the context is the Old Testament, eye for eye, tooth for tooth. The context is the distortion of this teaching. This teaching can be found in three places in the Old Testament, Exodus 21, Leviticus 24, and Deuteronomy 19. And at first glance, it can look like Jesus contradicting the Old Testament here, which he isn't doing. He does that sometimes, but he doesn't do it here. Every time the Old Testament talks about an eye for an eye or tooth for a tooth, it's only in one context. It's talking to judges about how they're to rule Israel, how they're to judge in light of things that are going on. It's about legal structures and procedures. And in Exodus 21, a few moments after it's mentioned an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, Moses says this, and it makes it clear what he's trying to get at. Verse 26, an owner who hits a male or female slave in the eye and destroys it must let the slave go free to compensate for the eye. And an owner who knocks out the tooth of a male or female slave must let the slave go free to compensate for the tooth. This is about appropriate and fair compensation. It's to ensure justice for the people of God and to limit the scope of justice. That's a fantastic idea, isn't it? It's a fantastic way to run society. But it's not so great when it comes to personal relationships. But that's exactly what the now-focused, me-focused, honor-focused religious teachers of the day were teaching. In your personal relationships, don't be a loser. Stand up for yourself. Love yourself. Be yourself. Assert yourself. They annoy you, well, you annoy them back. They're rude to you, you be rude to them back. They hit you, you hit them back. And that's the background. That's what they were teaching. But as I've been reflecting on this, like, I wonder how much teaching we need of this kind of thing. As I look at my own children, I don't think I have to teach them an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. If one hits the other's going to hit the other back. One bites the other's going to bite the other one back. Is it just my children? No, thank you, brother. I appreciate that. That's not just my children. It seems natural to me. Okay, I don't go around hitting people, but certainly I might daydream about it. Certainly might be just a little bit too happy when someone who's crossed me gets their comeuppance. Is that just me? Thank you, brother. It's in that context Jesus says, but I, the last prophet, the King of Kings, say to you, verse 39, look at it. Do not resist an evil person. That brings us to our main and first point. We're going to spend a long time here. It's on the sheet if you've got this. This will keep me honest and you optimistic. Do you use that? It's never okay to fight back. Jesus says it's never okay to fight back. Do not resist them, he says. Do not resist an evil person. Three questions to ask. First, what does it mean? Second, why do we find it hard? Third, why does Jesus put it like this? First, what does it mean? Well, Jesus, the great preacher, helps us with four illustrations, four snapshots of what it means. Firstly, if someone slaps you, he says, verse 39, if someone slaps you, worth noting, this slap is the slap of the right hand, most people are right-handed, onto the right cheek. This is a backhand. And as with then, as with now, a slap with the back of your hand is more of an insult than an act of violence. A backhand back then particularly was something you never do to an equal, something you do to a child or a slave. And so maybe we've never been slapped, maybe you have been slapped with a backhand before. Maybe you've never been slapped, but I presume we've all been insulted, called stupid or narrow or out of fashion. And Jesus says, instead of fighting back, invite them to do it again. Turn the other cheek. First snapshot. Second snapshot. He says, if someone sues you and they want the shirt off your back, I think the fact that they're suing you and the thing that they want is your shirt means you probably haven't got much in terms of worldly possessions. He's saying, even if they want your shirt, well, you should give them also your cloak. Give them the thing in Judaism which you're not allowed to take from someone because you might need that to keep warm at night. Give it to them. Third picture. Someone forces you to go with them as a Roman soldier was allowed to under Roman law for a mile. If they say, carry my shield, I'm feeling a bit tired. If someone does that, don't just do the mile that they're legally entitled to. Go for another mile. Fourth picture. Someone asks for money. In this society, they weren't using it for drugs or alcohol or prostitution, probably not in Jewish society. It's because they were unable to work. For whatever reason, they were unable to work, and so they needed to beg for food for their living. Jesus says, give it to them. Don't say no. Your teachers tell you to fight back. Your teachers say, fight the lawsuits. Your teachers say, tell those dirty Romans where they can put their bags and their shields. Your teachers say, refuse to give people money. And that might be what everyone else around you does, but not you. Not my disciples, not in the kingdom of heaven. I tell you, do not resist an evil person. I wonder what you make of that this morning. Maybe you're here for the first time, you're not a Christian, looking into the Christian faith, trying out church. Lovely to have you with us. As you're thinking about Christian things, as you're thinking about whether the Christian faith is for you, I wonder whether you'd be willing to live like Jesus speaks of here. I wonder whether this is the kind of life you're willing to embrace. I guess most of us here are Christian believers. Maybe we've been a believer for a while. I wonder what you've made of this. Presumably you've heard this before. I wonder if this is how you live. I wonder if this is how you want to live. Imagine there's all sorts of reasons why this might not make it onto your top 10 Bible verses, why this might not be the Bible verse that you have on your fridge on a magnet. I can imagine why some of us might want to find ourselves wishing that Jesus hadn't said this. Second question, why do you find it so hard? I think a couple of reasons. One, maybe we've misunderstood what Jesus is saying. You see, it could sound like Jesus is just saying we can never defend ourselves or anyone else, and we just have to allow anyone who wants to do anything to us just to walk over us. We're just this kind of doormat on which everyone can just wipe their muddy shoes all over us. Maybe you think that's what Jesus is saying. So you say this is ridiculous. This is weak. This is pathetic. This is nonsensical. And I think it can't be what Jesus is saying. Just five chapters after this, when Jesus is speaking to his disciples and they're talking about the persecution that's coming, Jesus says actually you're to flee that persecution. He doesn't just say stand there. He says run away. In Matthew 24, when Jesus says the Romans are going to come to destroy Jerusalem, he says, get out of there. I'm not just going to stand there letting them come and mow you down. Run, he says, scarper to the hills. Jesus himself, when he was being accused of being the devil, defended himself robustly in Matthew 12. When he was struck by a servant of the high priest, Jesus himself questioned the motive of the attack in John 18. Paul in Acts, when he refused to leave Philippi without he was chucked out of Philippi, but he refused to leave without a public apology for the way he'd been treated. Paul himself in Acts 23 put a curse on those who struck him. I think the rest of the Bible and Matthew make it clear that Jesus isn't commanding passivity in the face of evil. And so I need to be really clear this morning. When the vulnerable are being taken advantage of, when people are being bullied, when there's domestic abuse, when there's violence, where a crime is being committed, love and righteousness will mean that action must be taken, something must be said. Where there's gross unrepentant sin, I presume eventually church leadership will get involved. If it's a crime, I presume police will need to be involved. Certainly police will need to be involved. What Jesus is saying here, that even when action is being taken, We are not to pursue revenge. Instead, and this is the hard bit, instead, we're to pursue to bless them. Listen how Peter puts it. Peter was there as Jesus said this, presumably. He says this in his letter: "Do not repay evil with evil or insult with insult. On the contrary, repay evil with blessing, because this is what you are called, so you may inherit a blessing." Listen to how Paul puts it in Romans 12. "Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it's written, 'It's mine to avenge. I will repay,' says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he's thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you'll heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." I think sometimes we find it hard because we misunderstand what the Bible's saying. But I think also we can find it hard precisely because we understand exactly what the Bible's saying. Particularly in the mouth of Jesus. Jesus puts it very starkly: turn the other cheek, hand over your coat, go for 2 miles, give them your money. Third question, why does Jesus put it like this? Why does he put it so starkly, so provocatively? I don't know. I've been thinking about this for most of the last couple of weeks, actually. My best guess is, I think this is, if this isn't too irreverent, I think this is like first century clickbait. You know those ads, 3 habits of billionaires, click here. 5 things that the banks don't want you to know, click here. I think he wants us to engage and to think and to see and to feel just how utterly otherworldly this is. I think he wants us to ask questions and to wrestle with it. At the end of this section, he says, "Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect." He's setting out the perfect, the ideal Christian life, the life that he lived as he prayed for those who executed him. He wants us to see how utterly kingdom of heaven this is, how utterly far above the righteousness of the Pharisees this is. He wants us to feel how hard this is, because it calls us to other person-centeredness when we're so self-centered, to God-focusedness when we're so me-focused, to other world-focusedness when we're so this world-focused. He wants you to feel it. I wonder if you feel that this morning. Do not resist an evil person. If someone slaps you, turn the other cheek. I think he wants you to think, I can't do that, but I'd love to. Wouldn't you love to be so God and heaven and other person-centered that it didn't really matter to you if someone insulted you? Not really. Just water off a duck's back. Wouldn't you love to be so generous with your time and your money and your energy that you just didn't worry about it so much? You're free just to give it away. Wouldn't you love to be so confident about the life to come, the eternal glories, the pleasures at Christ's right hand, that losses in this life, well, they're not nothing, but they're just easier to bear? He wants you to hunger and thirst for righteousness. He wants you to see and feel that you can't do this, but with his help, with his Spirit living in you, maybe you might. John Stott, the great theologian and pastor of the last century, said this: "Nowhere is the challenge of the sermon greater," as in the Sermon on the Mount. "Nowhere is the distinctiveness of the Christian counterculture more obvious. Nowhere is our need for the power of the Holy Spirit more compelling. Is it ever right to fight back?" Jesus says no, and in a moment we'll ponder what that looks like practically. But before we do, there's something else we need to consider, and that brings us to our second point. But it is sometimes more evil not to fight back. When this whole kind of Will Smith slap Chris Rock thing happened, I came across one response which took me aback a bit. It was a tweet, I can't find it now, but I think it says something like this: "Will Smith is in the wrong for slapping him to defend his wife. Okay, so is Ukraine also in the wrong for killing Russian soldiers to defend their country? Will Smith's in the wrong, fighting back. Is Ukraine in the wrong for fighting back. I think the logic's a bit weak, they're slightly different, but it's not crazy to connect those two things. Let's put it another way. If this was a Christian country, and we had a Bible-believing Christian at our helm, and someone invaded us or made an attack on us, would we be praying for him on Sunday morning to turn the other cheek as a nation? Sounds crazy. Well, I was listening to something the other day where Andrew Wilson, who's a great speaker and writer, we have sold many of his books here, was saying this. He was saying, basically, in the light of the fact that every church father, every church leader before Constantine, in the first 3 centuries of Christendom, in the fact that all of them, whether it's Origen, Tertullian, Cyprian, Lactantius, in light of the fact that all of them agreed that killing image bearers was always a wrong thing, he said this, and listen to this. If you read the Sermon on the Mount and ask, what does it say that I do with Hitler? You go, yeah. You might have to say, I don't resist. Looking at these verses, thinking about our geopolitical kind of policies, he's saying, if you were a Christian, you would have to say, to be consistent, turn the other cheek. I wonder what you make of that this morning. I don't resist. I think we'd all agree that Hitler was an evil person. What I've just explained to you is Christian pacifism. It isn't some obscure Christian belief. There's always been pockets within the church that have believed it. As I said, in the first 3 centuries of the church, that was the kind of norm. Anabaptists believe it, Mennonites, Quakers. John Stott, who I quoted earlier, he didn't speak to his dad for 2 years because he refused to participate in World War II because of these verses. Many Christians, because of these verses, would say we shouldn't bear arms, we shouldn't fight in wars, we should trust God's sovereignty. And it's got to be said that there is something to this. War always results from sin and always leads to sin. Peace is something to be treasured in Scripture. It's the goal of our salvation, peace. We worship the Prince of Peace. He says, blessed are the peacemakers in the Sermon on the Mount, for they should be sons of God. And yet, from the 3rd century on, from the time where Christians were numerous enough and powerful enough to be making decisions about military action, people started reflecting on verses like Romans 13, which we'll look at in a minute, and concluding that there might be a case for justifying war biblically. Let's just turn to Romans 13. It's on your handout there. Let me just read it for you. Paul says this, let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. At this time, he's talking about Nero, who persecuted Christians. But so consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers hold no terror for those who do right, but for those who do wrong. Do you want to be free from the fear of the one in authority? Then do what is right, and you will be commended. For the one in authority is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for the rulers bear the sword for no reason. Sorry, do not bear the sword for no reason. They are God's servants, agents of wrath, to bring punishment on the wrongdoer. And so it's really interesting holding Romans 12, which we read earlier, up against Romans 13. Romans 12 says, we as individuals aren't to seek revenge. Vengeance is the Lord. We don't fight back because at the end of time, God is going to punish evil. However, it seems different for governments in Romans 12. Look at it at Romans 13. Look at it with me. Verse 1, we're told governing authorities, verse 1, are established by God. Why? Verse 4, well, part of their role is to be an agent of wrath, to punish the wrongdoer. They are not to turn the other cheek. They are not just to sit there and do nothing, trusting God's judgment in the end. What we're told they're to do, verse 4, to punish people now, with force, with the sword, with police, with armies, with courts, with prisons. And so while the Bible doesn't speak directly to this issue of should a Christian go to war, there's lots that we can deduce from, well, this distinction in Romans 12 and 13. There's lots that we can deduce from the fact that Jesus said that there will be wars and rumors of wars throughout history until he comes again. There's lots that we can deduce from the fact that when a Roman soldier asked John the Baptist what repentance would look like, John the Baptist didn't tell him to leave the army, he told him some other things to do. There's lots that we can take from the fact that there are a number of Christian centurions in the Bible, see Acts chapter 10. And because of that, many Christians have thought that sometimes war can be the lesser of two evils. You know the song, I was tempted to sing it, I'm not going to. War? Huh? What is it good for? Well, it's not absolutely nothing. Actually, for a government, sometimes under certain conditions, it's more evil not to start a war than to fight back. What are those conditions? Well, there's essentially three questions that we have to ask. We're not going to explore them. Let me just run you through them. The first is this: is the cause of war righteous? Is this war to stop something or someone evil? Is this the last resort? Is goal the peace? Is this initiated by a nation state and not just some kind of splinter group? Is this a righteous cause? Second question: are the means controlled and limited? Is the action proportional to the offense? You can't just nuke someone because they say something bad about you on Twitter. Is it controlled? Are the goals limited and clear? Is the outcome predictable? Will casualties be kept low? Is there actually a chance of success? But the thought is that if the cause is righteous, the means are controlled, and the goal is limited and clear, then this is a just war in the eyes of God. And actually, there's a moral duty to engage. It'd be a greater evil not to engage. Listen to Augustine, a third century bishop from Africa, who's one of the architects of what I've been describing, which some people call the just war theory. He says this: true religion looks upon as peaceful those wars that are waged not for motives of aggrandizement or cruelty, but with the object of securing peace, of punishing evildoers, and of uplifting the good. And therefore, if the war is just, it seems only right that Christians pray for peace and pray for victory. And they might find themselves fighting for peace and fighting for victory. And here's a question to discuss over lunch. I wonder if you think it possible that a Christian could work in the arms industry. Discuss. My time's up. A few concluding observations. I hope you feel the scope of what Jesus is calling us to hear as he tells us not to resist the evil person. There's no one and no area of life this won't affect. By saying we're not to resist the evil person, but even bless them, he's saying that every sphere of life, the Christian is called to be a blessing, even to the evil person, even to your enemy. And consistently, as you read through the Bible says this is going to be a fight. This is going to be a battle. James 4, verse 1 says, the Christian life, the experience of the Christian is to have desires which battle within us. I wonder whether that's your experience of the Christian life, a battle within you, warring desires, warring appetites. This is going to be a fight. In three ways, I think, as we end. Firstly, it's going to be an everyday fight. And by that, I mean it's going to be a daily fight and a very mundane fight. It's going to be a fight on the roads as some people drive like lunatics and seem to be blind to sight. I'm a cyclist and nothing gets me more annoyed than cycling. As people kind of try to kill me daily, it seems. It's going to be a fight. It's going to be a fight at work, as you speak to that annoying client, as you're interacting with your inept boss, as you're chatting with your self-absorbed colleague, at school, as people treat you badly, say bad things about you, people who you thought were your friends stab you in the back. It's going to be a fight at home as you're dealing with that slob of a housemate or husband. as you're annoyed by your spouse, as you're disciplining your children, and you ask the question, as I'm doing this, am I seeking to bless this person or just to get my own back? It's going to be a fight. I wonder if we're up for that this morning. It's going to be a fight which is going to be hardest to fight, because some of the reasons why people treat us badly is precisely because we're doing the right thing, precisely because we're trying to live for Christ. It's going to be a Christian fight. Here's a thought experiment. What would happen if I got you to get out your smartphone right now and go into your social media kind of thing of choice and type these words: thankful to God for the good that might come from the overturning of Roe versus Wade? What would happen if you did that right now? If your social media is anything like mine, I can imagine the responses wouldn't be entirely civil or respectful or cordial. If I asked you to do that, I can imagine most people wouldn't, for all sorts of reasons. But this is exactly the context that Jesus is speaking into. Before this, he says, 5 verse 11, blessed are you when people persecute you for righteousness. Just after this, he says, you're to love your enemies and pray for those who persecute. This is in the context of persecution for being Christian. He's saying, turn the other cheek. And Jesus is saying, when you feel holy indignation bubbling up inside you because someone's called you a bigot again or sworn at you again, when you're just trying to live for Christ, Jesus is saying, just stop. Maybe it'll help you remember, BPB, BPB. First, just breathe. Take 10 seconds, breathe. If you're online, maybe walk away from the computer physically before you do anything else. Second P, pray. Pray for them. Pray for those who persecute you, Jesus says. Pray, Father, bless this person made in your image. Father, may somehow I be a blessing to this person made in your image. And finally, B, do you bless them? Jesus says we're to be as wise as foxes, as innocent as doves. We need to work out, how can I be a blessing to this person, even though they've so enraged me? It's not going to be easy, but it is going to be a fight. Finally, it's going to be a fight of faith. It's missed off from your sheet, but it's going to be a fight of faith. This isn't just about our wills. This is about a fight to believe what God says about us, to believe that Jesus loves us more than we can know, even though we will get this wrong so often. It's wonderful, isn't it, to think that even when we were Christ's enemies, Christ died for us, that we might be blessed for all eternity. Jesus models this, and it's in this that we find our security. We need to fight that, believe that the future that he promises is so unbelievably glorious that even the most persecuted Christian on that final day will say that it was all worth it. I wonder if you believe that this morning. We need to fight to believe that when God says, vengeance is mine, he means it. To believe that we don't need to fight back now, because one day, the God of the earth, the King of kings, the Lord of lords, will fight for us. We're people of hope. And so we don't fight back. Let me give you a moment to pause, to reflect, and then we're going to sing a song about that hope. Just a few moments for us to pause and reflect.